Testing. Well, there we go. All right. Good to have everybody here today. We want to welcome you to this service and just so glad that you're here. This week has been Thunder Beach, and you've been out there riding your bicycles, right? But would you like some good news? You want some good news? Here's some good news. All right, we have a group here called the Faith Riders. They minister to people at Thunder Beach. They were able to share the gospel with over 700 people, and 78 people prayed to receive Christ into their life. Isn't that wonderful? That's good news. Praise the Lord for that. Again, we're glad that you're here. They heard about God's love. We're going to be singing about God's love here. You know, the Bible says God showed his love, how much he loved us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. What an amazing love. Let's all stand and worship the Lord today.
Good morning. Happy to be here.
Is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. All souls atoned by the blood of the Lamb. I'm not a slave. Power in the blood of the Lamb. white as snow, no other fount I know. I'm washed, I'm washed, I'm drenched in love. Oh, precious is the flow.
Had a different idea in mind this morning for that first verse, so we're just gonna go with it. I'm clearly drenched in love. As you can see, it's the bright lights, that's what it is. We're here to worship our God this morning. This next song is called Unstoppable God. We did it a few weeks ago, but I just want to read this verse real fast. It's in Isaiah chapter 40, verses 21. It says, do you not know, do you not hear, has it not been told to you from the beginning? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows on them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. Our God is unstoppable. It doesn't matter who's in charge, who the president is, whether you like him, you don't. It doesn't matter what storms come through. That doesn't matter because our God is in charge and he's the one that's ruling.
Yeah. Heaven thundered and the world was shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable.
Church, we're here today, sir. serving an incredible God, an unstoppable God. And we're going to sing out to the one who laid his life down for us. Let's praise him this morning.
Who's working in this year's VBS. This Tuesday, May 7th at 6 p.m. is the In the Wild VBS rally, and it's for you!
The animals are so cool, but at our rally, you'll also get an introduction to 3 up-close and personal encounters with Jesus.
And you'll get the new VBS handbook, sign up for a t-shirt, learn the motto and the theme song, and enjoy a snack while you mingle with other scouts.
Let's face it, people, it's a zoo out there. But coming to the rally will get you prepared to use your own encounters to help kids zoom in and focus on Jesus.
Hey everyone, smile and say cheese.
We gotcha. If you're in this snapshot, we'll see you at the rally.
Like I said, that camera was with a wide angle lens, so I'm pretty sure you're in that picture, which means I can't wait to see you on Tuesday night for our rally. 6 o'clock, we're getting ready for VBS. Now, I know we do that every year, right? Every year it's amazing, but guys, we've been through some stuff this year, haven't we? And we had the blessing of going through that with a relationship with Jesus. But look around. The harvest is white for us. So many people here in Bay County have gone through these same things without Jesus. Imagine that. So when we have Bible school, we get to put the gospel before them. Our verse this year says, "But these things were written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and by believing, you may have life in his name." So I'm excited. We get to tell them the gospel. If they trust Jesus, they leave here with life in his name. That's why we do it. It's worth it. Pray with me. Father, we call on you because you are a great and mighty God, able to do many things. Father, I just praise you for this body of St. Andrew Baptist, God. I pray that your spirit would just encourage us, Lord, to step up in our giving, step up in serving from our heart with you, in Bible school and in every other way you call us out. For truly the fields are white for the harvest. We love you, God. Speak to our hearts today. Make us more like you. Give us a joy and a zeal and a passion to take the gospel where we live. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. with a love that casts out fear. You are working and are waiting, sanctifying us. When beyond our understanding, you're teaching us to trust. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. Faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us.
Sing this with us, church.
You are wisdom unimagined. Who could understand your way? In the fire and the blood, faithful forever, perfect in love, you are sovereign over us. And even what the enemy means for evil, you turn it for our good, you turn it for our good and for your glory. In the valley, you are faithful. You're working for our good. You're working for our good, for your glory. And even when the enemy means for evil, you turn it for our good. You turn it for our good, for your glory. And even in the valley, you are faithful. You're working for our good. In the fire and the blood, faithful forever, perfect in love, you are sovereign over us. Faithful forever, perfect in love, you are sovereign over us.
Praise him today. I believe the men are taking up the offering. But let's just pray before Brother Mike comes up. Dear Father God, we love you and we are so thankful for you and who you are. And God, you're sovereign over us. And we can take that promise to the bank. And I don't know what could be more of a comfort to those of us who are in Christ is that you are sovereign. And what we go through, you've already been there. And you're there with us through it. And God, we praise you for that. So we just pray this morning, God, that you'll be with Brother Mike as he brings the word. I pray that if there's one soul in here that does not know you as your as their personal Lord and Savior, that you'll just touch their heart, God, and you'll draw them to you. I pray that you'll let us listen with our ears and our hearts and go out and be a light in our community. We praise you and thank you in your name. Amen.
Amen. For those of you that were not here last Sunday, and for those of you that were, but your memory doesn't quite last for 7 days, let me just remind you that we started a new study. We are looking at the Ten Commandments from a Christian perspective. How does a believer view and apply the Ten Commandments? You know, as followers of Christ, the Scripture tells us we're not under the law, but we are under grace. And we saw last week that the old covenant, of which the Ten Commandments is a part, was declared null and void by God in the days of Jeremiah because of Israel's disobedience to him. Yet in spite of that, Jesus refused to allow the words of the law to pass away. He said, "Do not think that I've come to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law until all is fulfilled." Therefore, while the old covenant of the law has been replaced by the new covenant, established through Jesus' shed blood for us on the cross, and while Christians are not required to keep the Old Testament law as the Jews once were required, still the law has value and validity for the followers of Christ. The Old Testament law, and most especially the Ten Commandments, reveals to us the character of God. God has not changed. From the days of creation to the days in which he gave the law, to the days in which Jesus walked upon the earth, to this day, God has not changed. His character is absolutely the same. And so as the law reveals the character of God, we can learn about that character. The Ten Commandments also reveal ways in which we can reflect the character of God in the way that we live day by day. And furthermore, the Ten Commandments take on a special importance when we understand that the Scriptures say that it was the Lord Jesus Christ himself. It was the second person of the Trinity who gave these commandments on Mount Sinai. Now, if there's any of those things that I just went over that you don't understand, or you're kind of scratching your head and saying, "Now, where in the Bible does it teach us those things?" Then go to our website and read or listen to the sermon I preached last week, because I took us through the Scripture. So if you missed that and you're wondering, how do we draw all of those conclusions, go back and look at the Scriptures that I walked us through last week to see these principles from God's Word. Now, I also shared with you three questions that we are going to use every week as we examine the Ten Commandments. Three questions that we are going to ask to help us identify the specific ways that God would speak to us as New Testament believers, as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, how he will speak to us out of these Ten Commandments. The first one is to ask, what does the commandment reveal about the character of God? Secondly, how does God want that portion of his character that's revealed in the commandment, how does he want that to show in our lives? And thirdly, we want to ask specifically, and what does the New Testament say that will help us to better understand this commandment, or will help us to better live it out in our day-to-day lives? So last Sunday, we began with the first of the Ten Commandments, where God said, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me." And what did this first commandment reveal? Well, it revealed to us that the eternal God who never changes, the creator God who made all of the universe and everything that's in it, and the redeemer God, specifically the Lord Jesus Christ himself, that is the one and only God who wants nothing, nothing to come before him in our lives. Now, the second commandment that we look at today is built upon the first. In Exodus 20, verses 4 to 6, God gives us the second of the Ten Commandments. Let us stand and read this portion of the Word of God. The Lord says, "You shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing mercy to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments." You may be seated. What does the second commandment reveal about God? Well, folks, first of all, it tells us that God knows that people are prone to worship the tangible in place of the invisible. It is just a natural characteristic of people that we are prone to worship the tangible, what we can see and touch, in place of him who is invisible. I mean, consider Moses. While Moses was still up on Mount Sinai, and the glory of God was showing up on that place, and God was giving to Moses the law, while the people camped at the base of the mountain were waiting on him. Now remember, this is the people who just months before had been delivered from years and years of bondage and hard slavery in Egypt. Now God, by his mighty hand, had brought them out, delivered them from the power of Pharaoh, had brought them to the Red Sea, and they thought that there was no escape. They were bound in by the mountains and by the Pharaoh's army pursuing, and there was nothing but deep water in front of them, and they saw God open the Red Sea, and they walked on dry ground through the bottom of the Red Sea with a wall of water on the right and a wall of water on the left, and God let them walk through that Red Sea and march out to the other side. And then they saw, as Pharaoh's army pursued, the waters closing upon them and to take their would-be captors again to their death. This was only months ago. And now their leader Moses is up on the mountain meeting with God, and they can see the lightning flashing, and they can see the brilliance of the glory shining. But what do? They are so prone to worship the tangible in place of the invisible that they make for themselves a god of gold, the golden calf. And they bow down and worship it, and they have the nerve to call that the God who delivered them. How prone to worshiping other gods and idols people are. Sadly, this tendency to worship idols and false gods, like the other nations round about them, became the story of Israel themselves. Time and time again, they fell into this false worship. And ultimately, it caused God to declare the covenant broken and to send the nation into captivity. Now, folks, we should understand that this commandment is not a prohibition of all artwork The focus here is not upon just the making of things. The prohibition is on making something to bow down to, of making something to serve, which is the essence of worship, of worshiping other things that are made by our hands or the hands of others. And you might be saying, well, Brother Mike, how can you be sure about that? How are you sure that God's not just telling us not to make statues or images at all, no matter what we do with them? Well, I can be sure because God himself commanded Moses to make an image. Do you remember when the children of Israel were in the wilderness and they had been murmuring, complaining about this manna, the food that God gave them to eat every day they were in the wilderness? But they had had it so long, you know, if you eat steak every day, you get tired of it, don't you, folks? Say, I wouldn't know, never done that. Well, you would. I've never done it either, but you would. Well, they got tired of the manna. And they complained about God's provision of what he was providing for them to eat out there in the wilderness when there was no other food. And so in response to their complaining, God sent serpents. And they were called fiery serpents because their bite burned. The venom, when it flowed in the veins, felt like fire was flowing through your veins until finally it took your life. When the people finally repented, recognizing that this judgment came because of their own murmuring and complaining against the Lord, Numbers 21 says, then the Lord said to Moses, make a fiery serpent, set it on a pole, and it shall be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, shall live. The image of a serpent provided a way for people to demonstrate their faith in God's provision. God said, if you look at it, then you will be healed and live. Now, they were not to worship it. They were not to serve it. They merely looked on it and by their looking expressed their faith that God had made a provision for their sin. Now the text of this commandment says what was implied in the first commandment, that God is a jealous God. Now we saw that demonstrated in the first commandment, but here it is written. Folks, remember, God is jealous not because he desires to protect his own turf. God is not worried about somebody taking him off of the throne. But he is jealous on our behalf. He does not want us to displace him and to follow someone else or something else in worship because he does not want us to be separated from him. And so he warns us about the sin of bowing down to or serving idols and false gods. And he tells us, folks, this sin is especially contagious to our children. Listen to this. This sin is especially contagious to our children. My friend, if you are here without Christ, maybe your attitude has been, I want to live my life my own way, and when the end comes, man, I can take it. I mean, I'll just accept the consequences, whatever they are, but I'm going to be my own man, I'm going to be my own woman, I'm going to live life the way I want to, and then I'll deal with it when the end comes. But I plead with you, my friend, not to just think about the consequences in your own life, but think about your children. Because when we worship other gods, the effects do not just come just to us, but they come to our children. This sin is especially contagious. So the Lord says, I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing mercy to thousands to those who love me and keep my commandments. Now, folks, sometimes people just glancing at this verse respond by saying, but that's not fair. That's not fair. God should not punish the children for what their parents did. Folks, let me tell you something that will be a good thing to keep in the front pocket of your mind where you can reach it really quickly. Whenever something prompts you to say or to even think, God's not fair, what that means is you don't know the whole story. You don't know everything about it. Folks, God is better than fair. God is just. And justice is always far more righteous than just being fair. But God not only is always just, God is overflowing with mercy. And God allows mercy to flow to show kindness in many places where justice would only bring pain. So just write this down on one of those little post-it notes and stick it on the front of your mind. God is better than fair. He is just and merciful. And when you're tempted to say or think God is not fair, just pull out that note and read it again and believe it. It is true. God is always just. And better than just, he overflows with mercy. Now let me show you how that applies in this case. When we read this commandment, we need to read it all. We need to read the fine print along with the part that just grabs our attention. Because, you see, the scripture says of itself that every word in the Bible is breathed by God. That means every word is important. None of his words are superfluous. So let's look at this commandment again. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing mercy to thousands to those who love me and keep my commandments. So here's the situation. The father is an idolater, worshiping an idol instead of the God who created him, and his children and grandchildren hate God. We do not know why they hate God, but the fact that they hate him tells us that they have not trusted him. They are not believers. They're not saved, because no one who trusts in God hates God. So God visits the iniquity of their sin of unbelief upon the children and grandchildren, which is the same sin committed by father and our grandfather. But they are punished, not because they are children of the idolater, but because they themselves reject God and refuse to trust in him. Folks, the problem is not that God is not fair. He is more than fair. He is just and merciful. In fact, come back to those children and grandchildren that hate God. They had an idolatrous father and grandfather, and this sin is contagious, and they don't believe, they don't trust, and now they hate God. But even though their father and grandfather were idolaters, God still desires to show them mercy. Just read a few chapters hence after Exodus chapter 20 and Exodus 34. It says, the Lord God is merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. And then you go to Leviticus, And you say, is there anything good in Leviticus? Oh, yeah, a lot. Listen to this. Leviticus 26. But if they confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers, if their uncircumcised hearts are humbled and they accept their guilt, then my covenant with Abraham I will remember. Which covenant is what made them the children of God? And the Abrahamic covenant continues to this very day, fulfilled in the coming of Christ. So if the children or the grandchildren, although they had an idolatrous father and grandfather, they were not raised in the ways of God nor encouraged to believe in God, and so they hate God. But if they will turn to the Lord in humility, repenting and trusting in Him, then they will be shown mercy and they will be forgiven of their sin. God is more than fair. Folks, God is just and merciful. Now come with me back to the main point here. And that is that the sin of idolatry is very contagious, especially to our children and our family. Men, ladies, if we ourselves are led into idolatry, we not only risk our own eternal destiny, we are leading those that we love the most down the most dangerous pathway that they could encounter. No, they will not be condemned for our sins. But if they adopt our rebellion against God, and if they refuse to trust Him, our influence will at least be in part responsible for encouraging them to make a disastrous choice in rejecting God. So let's move to the second question. How does God want this portion of His character, that He is a jealous God, that He wants nothing to come before Him? So He doesn't want us to make any images that we would worship. How does He want that to show, to be reflected in our lives? Well, folks, we honor the one true God by absolutely refusing to bow down or to serve anyone or anything else. And you know, most of us in this room would say, well, hey man, I'm fine with that. You won't find any idols in my place. And I certainly hope that is true. But let me suggest some idols that are often found among people today that lead people unthinkingly to offend the character of our God who is jealous. You know, in some religions that call themselves Christians, in fact, members are taught to pray to Mary, the earthly mother of Jesus. And prayer is certainly one way to bow down to someone or to something. Others bow before a statue of Mary or one of the other saints. Folks, this is a direct disobedience of this commandment. Some folks have some type of a good luck charm. Maybe something they carry in their pocket or wear around their neck or keep handy. And when they especially want something to turn out the way they want it to, they may reach out and touch it or rub it or even kiss it. Some pray to or converse with a dead parent or a dead sibling or a dead friend, seeking from them some comfort or some advice or for them in some way to intercede on their behalf in the difficulties that they're facing. Folks, this is not only idolatry, but this is what the Bible calls necromancy, which means contacting or attempting to contact the dead. Let me tell you, this is especially dangerous because though a person will have no ability to really contact the dead, you cannot call up your dead mother or your dead father and really talk with them. A demon can impersonate one of the dead. A demon can impersonate your dead father, your dead mother, or a dead sibling, or a dead friend to whom you were close. They can impersonate that dead person that you loved and make you think that you are communicating with your loved one who has passed, and thus lead you into spiritual peril. So our third question, what does the New Testament say that helps us to understand this commandment better or how to live it day by day? Now, if you think that my list of modern idols that I offer to you was somewhat narrow-minded, just wait till you hear the words of Jesus. Hear what he had to say. Because he warned us about mankind's most common false god. In Matthew chapter 6, Jesus said, "No one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he'll be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon." Jesus warned us not to bow before the idol of mammon, which means riches or wealth. Jesus said, you cannot serve God and money. Now, when we hear that, immediately many of us think about those that we know who are rich. But guess what? According to the global rich list, do you know that most of the people in this room would be among the top 1% of the most wealthy people in the world? Did you know that? You say, well, maybe so. Not me, buddy. not me. Well, let me tell you this. If your income is just on the level of what our federal government classifies as the poverty level, just the level, if you make that much money, you are in poverty. Listen, at our medical clinic, we even allow someone to make twice that amount. They can be two times the federal poverty level and still get free medical care at our clinic. But if you just make enough money to be at what the federal government says is the level of poverty, do you recognize that you are still in the top 15% of the wealthiest people when you consider everybody that lives in the world? Folks, if you live in America, you are among the wealthy and the rich. And so Jesus is speaking to us. Jesus is talking to us. Now understand, the Bible does not condemn having money, but it does speak strongly against pursuing money or pursuing wealth. And Jesus warns us, it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. So that is a warning to all of us Americans. It is a warning to every one of us who is seated in this place that we better be careful not to pursue wealth and riches, but to serve only God. Paul wrote to Timothy. He said, command those who are rich in this present age to not be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who gives us richly all things to enjoy. And Paul warned us that covetousness, the desire for things that we do not have, is actually idolatry. That covetousness, wanting things we don't have, is idolatry. He says it in Colossians chapter 3. He says, therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. So how do we obey this commandment? How do we heed these fearsome warnings of letting ourselves fall into the worship of some idol or something other than the Lord our God? Folks, I believe one of the keys came from the mouth of the Lord Jesus himself. When the devil tempted him to worship the evil one. You remember when Jesus was out in the wilderness and Satan came to him to tempt him right before Jesus began his earthly ministry? In Matthew 4, we read this portion. It says, again, the devil took him, that's Jesus, up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And the devil said to Jesus, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. And then Jesus said to him, listen to this. Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. Well, there Jesus gives us the key, folks, of what we are to do, of what will allow us to say no every time we are tempted to bow down or to serve something else. He says that we are to worship the Lord our God, and we are to serve the Lord. Worship the Lord our God. Folks, this doesn't just mean going to church, but I would remind you that none of us worships as well in the long run alone. We worship better in the company of other believers. And it means that worship needs to be a priority for us. And the priority needs to be not just coming together, but to worship. That when we come to worship, when we come into this place or into another place to worship, we actually come to worship. That is our goal, that is our desire. We don't come just to visit with friends. It's okay to visit with friends, but that's not our primary motivation. We walk in those doors, we drive to this place, we get up and get ready. All the things are involved that come to worship, but we come with the motivation that we want to worship the Lord our God. And worship primarily has three parts: praising God for who he is, thanking God for what he has done, and trusting God, committing to faith, repenting over any disobedience or lack of faith that has been in recent times in our life, and expressing our faith, expressing our trust in him. Jesus said, worship the Lord your God. And then he said, serve the Lord. Recognizing he is the master. That's what Lord means. And we are his servants. That we have chosen to follow him. We have chosen the path of obedience. And so we need to practice what Jesus did. When he took the towel and wrapped it around himself, and he went and he washed the feet of his disciples. Because Jesus, though he was Lord and is Lord, came not to be served, but to serve. And our heart attitude needs to be that of a servant. And we need to be especially obedient to serve the Lord in the way he told us to serve him. That means to be actively involved in the making of disciples. You know, Jesus said, go and make disciples. And actively being consciously a witness to Jesus. He said, you are my witnesses. And to be that witness everywhere that he told us to be, in our Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the very ends of the earth. That is serving Jesus. Folks, if we will actively be engaged in our worship, and we will actively be spending our lives in the service of Jesus, when the temptation comes, as it did to Christ, to bow down and worship other gods, we too will be able to say, get behind me, Satan. Stand with me. Let's pray. As we stand with our heads and our hearts bowed before the Lord, may I ask you, are there any idols, whether they were mentioned today or just the Spirit brought them to your mind, anything that draws your worship or service, that causes you to bow down? And while we just stand quietly before the Lord, make it a time of repentance, a time of confession, a time of commitment, our renewed commitment to the Lord. How are you doing in this battle about the pursuit of riches? Is it something that draws you, that captures your time and your energy, that is a focus for your heart, that is a great desire of your heart? Then lay it aside today. Jesus said it's the most common battle we fight, but no one can serve both wealth and God. And how's your worship? Do you really give it priority in your life? Do you give it priority to come together with other believers to worship? Or is the priority the ball games when they come on Sunday? And worship comes when there's not a game? Or is the priority the Disney trips? You know, you're got an annual membership, so you're wasting money if you don't use it. Or is a priority other weekend vacations that come pretty often, and worship just falls in when there's not anything else going on the weekend? How's your priority in worship? Is there repentance? Is there commitment that needs to happen? This is a time just between you and the Lord. When you come, how's your worship? Do you come mainly to be with others, just to enjoy the music? Or do you come to enter into the singing, to enter into the praying, so that you personally are expressing your praise to God for who He is? And you're telling God, thank you for the good things He's done. Things He's done long ago that still benefit you, or things He's done just yesterday or today. But do you engage in worship? Wow. Folks, the implications of these first two commandments can be overwhelming. But if we will follow the example of our Lord, to make worship a priority of our life and service of the Lord and His kingdom the activity of our life, we can have victory over these temptations. Father, may it be so in our lives. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In our time of continued worship, which also is a time of invitation, if there's someone here who would come to Christ, you come to one of us who are standing here to receive you. If there's someone who wants to come into our church family, you come. will help you with that. If there's a commitment that you need to make, or you just want to spend some special time in prayer with the Lord, the altar's available. Just come. Either stand or get on your knees before the Lord. While we sing, you come.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now. That taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are
Church, it's been good to be here and worship with you this morning, hasn't it? It's been good. I'd like you to do something with me. I'd like you to watch this very important video.
Buenos dias, Iglesia.
Did someone say Alicia?
No, Iglesia. It means church.
Oh, what about church?
We have a special announcement for them.
Ooh.
We are excited to invite you to our 11th annual Cake and Silent Auction. It's to raise money for our high school mission trip to Mexico.
That's right, church. It's tonight. 5 to 8:30, we are here in the gym. This is one of the funnest events you can attend all year.
Last year, we raised over $15,000 for our youth mission trip. God is so good, and His people are so generous. We can't wait to see what He will do this year.
Through our mission trip last year, we were able to lead over 50 people to faith in Christ. Without this auction, that would not have happened.
We will have child care for babies through pre-K, and dinner is provided.
It's not too late to bring a cake or a donation for the auction. See Brother Mark at the welcome desk for details.
And don't forget, you can bid on a pie to pie your favorite minister in the face. That's always a fun time. Muchas gracias. Adios.
Church, this is one of the funnest, well, except for the pie. It's one of the funnest times that we'll have this year. And let me just tell you, speaking from experience, what we do tonight is important. It's important for two reasons. It's important because our small children that we bring will see that we are serious about showing our faith and sending people on mission. But it's also important because experientially I've seen what it means in the life of my children. And I want you to know it's important. It's important what we do tonight. It's going to be important how we give. We give generously. And listen, this is certainly one night a year that we get to give hilariously. So it's going to be fun. Let's don't call this an end this morning. Let's call it a beginning. Let's understand that there's not supposed to be any other gods before our great God. And Jesus said it a little bit differently. He said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And that's what we need to be doing this week. Here's your benediction, church. Now the God of peace who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord, equip you in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. You're dismissed to your small groups.